So I have this China made Sil3114 card I bought for a project some year or two ago, and one of the ports were broken. I fixed that yesterday. It was just a question of resoldering these here. You have caps over here. Your port over here basically goes to the row of caps here and here, and then over to here. And one of these ports had some legs here, like three of them were really black, looked like some kind of almost corrosion. I don't know what's happened, but they hadn't soldered properly, so fixed that yesterday and just tested the card to make sure the port works, because I don't want to waste time on a card like this, otherwise it's like 20 euros or something shipped. But all ports works now, so 4 out of 4 instead of 3 out of 4. Next problem with this card is that it comes pre-flash like all of them with the arrayed BIOS. There are multiple BIOSes for these cards usually. An ID BIOS, a RAID BIOS, and then there is the RAID 5-ish BIOS that differs from the RAID BIOS, which is only RAID, I think, 0, 1 and maybe 10. And this EEPROM here is a really old Intel one that needs 12 volts for programming. So it's not even supported by the flash software, so I can't remove the firmware on it and replace it with something else. And the reason I want an ID BIOS, it's instead of the RAID BIOS. The main reason is that optical drives tends to not to work with the RAID BIOS. So if you want to use a hard drive and an optical drive in your retro machine, you're basically out of luck with the RAID BIOS. The ID BIOS tends to work a lot better, more compatible, and really, it's gonna run RAID on a 25-year-old computer or something. And if you do, you don't do it on a thing like this. So I have this chip here, which is supported. So the plan is to remove the old one and actually put a socket in here, so we can actually swap BIOSes if we want to, like physically swap them if we need to. If we're gonna remove it anyway, you might as well put a chip on it. My plan was to put some foil over this thing to protect it. There's some, I don't want to burn the connectors next to it and the cap, so I figured some foil would probably help out a little bit. It's still gonna get hot, but maybe not that bad. Mainly the connectors I can, but I don't want to burn here. That. Make sure those are somewhat protected. Everything looks like it's in one piece still, so that's good. So we want to clean this up now so we can add a socket. Oh, that should be good enough. So yeah, I think it looks good. Then I get the socket for that. So that should go like that, something like that. This is no clean flux, so it's not really a problem if I can't clean it away later. Obviously I'm gonna clean this card anyway, but it has no ill effects on, like, it's not conductive or anything like that. So we can be generous if we want to anyway. getting like halfway there. This is actually my first time trying on one of these sockets, so. And yeah, it takes more steadier hands and a slightly smaller tip. I've got 1.6 and that goes in between pretty much anything here, but it's so close it's easy to do some burn marks in the plastic. But that's better to live with a few burn marks as long as they have no real impact. So, after some fiddling, I think we got them all. So I'm just clean this socket out now. A few burn marks in the socket in the plastic, but it's not too bad. It's, well, I haven't done one of these before, so it's my first. But I figured, why not try it on one of these Chinese cards, when it's like broken anyway. I really can't bother to complain about the SATA port, and I fixed it, so the ROM is what the ROM is, there's no worry. But it's no guarantee what you get there, you get whatever they find, I suppose. need to put in, I have one wrong here. This one is supported in the flashing software. It's an AM29F010B. So, obviously it doesn't contain the right software, right firmware. But I think we should be able to flash it from DOS anyway. If we specify the card and so on, I think we don't need a working firmware on it, we just need a working card. With a working ROM chip. Hopefully, if they design the thing right, we should be able to program it on, directly on this card. Don't have an EEPROM burner yet, so. So yeah, I suppose that's the next thing to do. Let's try to burn a ROM to this. And I do have a computer next to me prepped for this, so I'm just gonna populate the new slot with the new chip here. Like so. And put it in the computer. So we have the card here. Gonna put it in this computer here. We can flash it and hope it works. So the system is booting. So when a UDP flash, UDP flash, now we need a BIOS D5.44.3. Yes. Let's see about, let's see if we have a controller card. I did try another BIOS before and it didn't work, but then I realized that's not the BIOS I usually use. I haven't even tested that one, so it seemed broken. So hopefully this one, well, this one worked. That was why I complained about it being newer. So yes, that means we have a working card actually, with the right BIOS, so I can power this off. So I have the system here we can test the card on. Just gonna remove the other card. It's the same kind of card, just a different brand. So this is our Sil3114 also. The reason I switched system is because I had, like I said, ID on another one, so easier to flash from a working hard drive. This one is completely reliant on the card to work, so I'm gonna try that out. And yes, it's water cooled, so I'm just gonna make a little bit of noise now. A little bit of air in the loop. So we have a card detected. Windows. Properties, discuss the controllers. And there we have a card. So yeah, they're working. So yeah, thank you for watching.